You were making an argument that there was no natural, way to do a, to create a random three-dimensional space.
Yes.
And there's random surfaces, but there's not random
three-dimensional. Right. Exactly, because it's very, in a naive way, it's highly far from any independent. There are two major correlations which are out of control. It doesn't mean there is no theory, but the theory might be really different. I don't know what kind of theory, maybe not. It's definitely a very good question. You have to play with this and come with something, but the answer will answer a different question. You have to change your question. But I don't know how. People do that, they make high dimensional this, high dimensional this, cheating. What they do is trivial.
So what did Frolic do about surfaces? Well, That's how we started this.
I forgot, I read this article one year ago, very superficially, much more elaborate, of course. Yeah,
okay.
It's a highly elaborate paper.
No, it's funny you say that, because you say you did this great work in the 80s.
Yeah, in the 80s. Yeah.
I think I was probably at IHES then.
Yeah, maybe.
And I went into his office one day. Mm-hmm. I said, hi. What are you working on? I said, oh, I'm working on random surfaces. He said, oh, what are random surfaces? He started telling me, and then he thought that this is too hard a problem for mathematicians.
And you know, he's right, because papers which were written then by mathematicians is much more simpler.
What?
Much simpler. Everything was written up to that, I think, was by mathematicians. Just
everything we do is very simple.
We have a baby level.
Yeah, we have a baby level. But it's correct.
Correct. I think his paper is correct. His paper is correct. It's really good. It's my intention to study this paper. It's really good. And then you understand.
Are there any graduate students here? Yeah. You don't have to believe everything he says.
No, actually, you never believe anything.
You have to sort of
anything.
Think about it. You can't forget it, though.
Never.
Don't believe it.
Don't believe anything.
Right, that's what he told us.
Yeah. That's the whole point of my lecture. Is I'm trying to destroy certain beliefs. And indeed, we are blinded. I think we have a lot of beliefs. Don't realize them, that we have them. Even inside mathematics, apparently you have to know better.
Yes, sometimes you do research by sort of painfully rejecting everything that you have thought up to that point, you know, and then maybe just change it somehow.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. This
it's hard to do, though.
It's hard.
So you mentioned earlier that numbers were the wrong way to think about numbers. How do you like to think about numbers? What is the correct notion of numbers?
What do you mean by numbers are the wrong way to think about numbers?
No, well,
when you say numbers. What do you mean?
Within mathematics, you have no objection. But if you look, so what numbers are in physics? And everything, you know, from physics, everything doing numbers. But numbers have meaning only up to a point, yeah? So if you have very small, very big numbers, they have no physical meaning. Yet physics created these numbers, like probability of a system being a mistake. And I think only because you know equality between the numbers, but you don't have numbers anymore.
Or inequality. You also know inequality.
No, they're so small, the inequality I don't think makes sense. If you have kind of 10 to the minus 10 to the 10 with an inequality. You just know they're equal. Different states are equal. Say inequality is what the hell it means. It's inequality. Equality, yes, and then have the symmetry, and then you can manipulate them and write good formulas. But inequality is a very big point. Inequality is, another point.
Yes. So, inequality is the only thing that makes sense?
Okay, good point. Imagine you have the following statement. This transitivity of inequality, if I is greater than B, B is greater than C, then A is greater than C. Can you formulate mathematically? Transitivity of inequality. So I accept it. So there will be no kind of, no junk in the sense. At least 100% rigorous. I'm claiming it's impossible. Already I'm saying, I'm already confused. A, B, B, C. So, you see, I only could say it because I already assigned some sounds to them and put them in temporal order. But imagine you don't have a priori temporal order. You don't have a priori spatial order. Try to explain what it means. A greater than B and B greater than C implies whatever. You cannot
say. I compute enough significant figures to see that they're bigger.
I mean, here.
Huh?
No, exactly. Without appeal, it's externally, only intrinsically within mathematics. You cannot do it. Mathematical language.
Oh, I'm talking about as a scientist.
Well, as a scientist, of course. As a scientist, you can do it because you don't have to be. You can do that, but you can convince, but it's still kind of, it's still not. You know, you always confuse science and mathematics, right? A greater than B, B greater than A, hard to remember. It's not accidental. You know, this joke, it's kind of that a man was learning English by contradiction. You know that, yeah?
No.
You know that, yeah?
I don't know.
Yes,
he
was like, how well you learn English? Oh, because you just, white and black, strong and weak, cold and hot, and I keep everything here in my ass. So we have difficulty, you see, evolution, and we switch all the time. But there is a good reason for that, because it depends on certain physical background. Without each, because already when you say A greater than B, it makes sense because already they are written in a certain order. And without this order, the sign makes no sense. You know, there is A, there is B, and there is sign of order. But you know, directed specifically, it's already there must be ordering between A and B. So there is A, B, and sign of comparison sign. How do you know this position and this position? Because you already have orientation by this page. You don't have it a priori, you cannot say it. And therefore,
what are you talking about? Symbols? What are you talking about? Symbols?
So you're talking about symbols and also no, temporal
not the symbols.
Huh?
There is, no, you have A, B, and there is a relation between them. How you know which one? A, B, or B, A? How you know which order this A and B appear? You already need order. First come A, then come B, and between there is a symbol. But how you know of order A and B? Because you say them in some order. If you don't have spatial order, you cannot say it, or temporal order.
Maybe you got these. Maybe there you have two objects. And maybe they came from some category where there was an arrow between them, in one direction.
How did in category they come with arrows. An arrow already is there, so it's already there is arrow.
I'm saying maybe A came from somewhere, maybe B came from somewhere, and then that somewhere.
Yeah, but exactly, it's used to speak metaphorically. You know, there are this concept in mathematics which have non-mathematical, like matrix. What is a matrix?
What is a what?
Matrix.
Matrix?
What is a matrix? A square table or? It's a basket, I mean, just like that, yeah. It's the same. It's the same concepts of order. It's like matrix. It's not a mathematical concept. It's how you write things on the blackboard. They're about a pencil, and the same about A greater than B. And they're not truly mathematical. And this is not a joke. I think in your mind, it's exactly how the knowledge is organized. You have to be careful.
If I have Cartesian coordinates on the plane, I can say what a matrix is.
No, it's very, very particular. Cartesian, careful. So, but it's not that we have to do the definition, right? I think you can do that, but the matrix is defined as some square table, and it doesn't have the Cartesian coordinates on the plane. Matrix not, that doesn't depend on Cartesian coordinates,
no,
or
no,
real
no.
numbers.
I can have a set of objects, and I can have
relationship.
No,
but this
is
artifact. But this will be artifact. Yeah, you artificially create something to make sense of what is in, does make sense. You can do it in many different ways, right? And why you do it this way? And this, but then all the time you say matrix, you have to remember these coordinates. When you make computation, where is your coordinates?
So well,
you
matrix are different from linear transformation.
No, but you carry them. No, but you carry them in your notations, what you said. Exactly, you can't do that, but then you have a huge thing, and then you keep it all along. It's exactly
no, it's problem. Like a Markov process. Okay. Matrix is a Markov process. I love it. I mean, you have transitions from state I to state J.
Wait, but the moment you say it, you confine yourself to a specific thing, and then you're obliged to carry it with every step. Then different methods.
No, but then if you do the process once and then do it again, it is the multiplication.
No, but you describe now matrix of numbers. But the matrix have matrix of of residues.
I mean, matrix of elephants.
What you know, they're not numbers, but you know that residue must serve. So you have
then
to
I
say,
have to take,
again, we have to say again. You don't have
to do add 2 plus 2 the way
no, but the definition doesn't work. Exactly. You cannot do it rigorously. This is what I'm saying. You cannot do it rigorously and consistently. It's not a joke. I mean, it's not accidental. Many mathematical concepts, and that I think.
Well, your question, what is a matrix? It wasn't about matrices of numbers.
No, because the point is you already have special structure. No, it's matrix in general. For example,
in general, what does that mean?
It's a square table where it puts whatever you want. And that's a good definition, except that
you... Cartesian coordinates on the plane.
Yeah. Well, no, we don't say it. You enforce some structure which is not there. It's a metaphoric concept. And giving precise meaning is dangerous because you meet the narrow vision. But if you think how your brain works, it's a problem. Because you don't have spatial structure in your brain. Your temporal structure is different in different parts of the brain. Therefore, these concepts, order relation is not there. There is no natural order relation in your brain. If you settle for that. Exactly.
Well, Maker is this thing where you could do that argument with the rows and the columns. That nice argument you gave. That's what Maker does.
Rows
and columns.
Sure, I agree. It's a nice argument. It's a nice theorem. But you use that. But however, I start thinking about that. If you try to model the work of your brain, and your brain have no a priori spatial structure, and it has no a priori temporal structure, because the different parts, so how you encode these concepts? And you have problem, everybody of us has difficulty with inequalities. And every member is basically inequalities. One is bigger than the other, who in every member?
Yeah, but we're born with a retina, which is a two-dimensional thing where we can put the matrix.
No, but you don't have it, it's not there. It's not where thinking happens. It doesn't happen on your retina, or not even, it's not retina, of course, your V1, where it remembers part of the spatial structure. It's first visual point. But it's not where your thinking happens. It's completely in different domain. And we make mistakes with orders all the time. You know, I think most of us have difficult to remember what is that maximum or minimum of somebody, big or smaller. Right, it's completely arbitrary. It's a evolution, tick, 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 tick. You cannot tell the rituals. Obviously, there's an evolution there.
Wait, the point to which you reduce things, like how do you even tell two objects apart? Like how do you even know what A is and what B are?
That's a good point. And but for some reason, in your brain, these things are associated. You know they are related. That's exactly how I think the mind works. It knows objects are related. That's fact of relation.
Or distinct.
No, related. No, those which are related, forget about this job. This is exactly the point. You have matrix of zero and ones. There are ones. There is no zero. If you start remembering all zeros, you're dead. That's another point. You know which are related. Those which are related, you don't remember. They're not in your mind. That's one point. And you know which are related. And you don't know a priori how they're related. There is no name for this relation a priori. And then there is a relation between the relations. You say, this relation are related. But you don't know again how they relate. And all the combinatorics of that, what makes sense of that. But there is no concept of inequality. It emerges a posteriori, but not a priori. But relation is there. Even equality is not quite clear to me about equality. That's maybe there, maybe not.
What if your brain can't actually control the relation? What if your brain actually doesn't know when two things are related? What if one knows, what are the signs of the probability? It might actually say, these two things are related, when they're not actually related because there's some sort of error probability of, I'm relating two things which actually aren't related.
No, but again, his brain, of course, this is kind of undercurrent of your mind, not exactly the brain, but this is a modeling. You can expect what happens in your brain. So the first level of structure imposed, there are units, whatever they are, and then some of them considered related and which are unrelated, we don't know.
What if they're wrong? What if it's all wrong?
What's wrong?
All the relations.
Okay, so they're wrong. Maybe wrong. What do you mean wrong?
I don't know.
What's right or wrong? You observe the world and something you find being related. Of course, you may have a wrong picture of the mind, of the world. But the point is that conjecturally, there are simple way how out of that relation to make and reconstruct the world. Maybe the picture of the world we have completely wrong. Well, in a way, in many respects, very much wrong. But it's rightness or wrongness is kind of immaterial. It's just the question is how kind of nice it is. Right? The reality is of the world depends, determined by the kind of elegance of its representation in your mind.
How
arithmetic will be made, actually, I don't know that. Actually, I have a little daughter, and she does arithmetic, I don't know how she does it. She thinks, then give the right answer. And she certainly doesn't know the rules. And so that's a wrong answer, but if you say wrong, she can correct it easier. That's complicated numbers, multiply.
Now, arithmetic, do you mean the theory of numbers? You're doing that. You mean computations?
No, like the theory of numbers.
Do the theory of numbers.
Yeah.
That's what he meant by arithmetic. Right? The axioms, piano axioms for arithmetic or something. that what you meant, sort of at a logical level?
No, but of course in your head there is no...
I don't know what, I'm just trying to clarify the question.
Not even at a logical level, like I would just like, I'd like to be able to say there's some sort of a structure, it's a discrete structure, I've got inverse operations, I can go backwards, well at least add to the inverses, I can multiply...
No, but this is what you do in mathematics, it's not what happens in your mind. In your mind, you have a completely different story, nothing like that. There's no reason to expect it being in your mind.
My mind works like that. No.
Oh, no. Because you see, you cannot recognize numbers, say, about 5 or 6 or 7. You don't see them, right?
I do.
No, come on. Some people say I can 7. No. Yes, if you look, you recognize 2 and 3 in a...
Well, I count quickly, though.
Look exactly what it takes half a second.
Right? Fives. 3-2-3-2-3-2.
Okay.
Yeah.
No,
it's pretty
long. You know, the reaction of if animal would react like that, say 300 milliseconds, they would be dead. You know, they have to react usually the order 50 milliseconds. That's the immediate reaction. And you know, some animals react to eat something or not to eat in 10 milliseconds. That's the right reaction. You recognize 1 and 2 at this speed. And come to 5, it takes about 300 or 400 milliseconds.
Milliseconds. Like a bat flying along has to decide whether to eat the...
No, not fly. There are some, this big distance is longer. I speak, there are some particular, how they call, moles. The moles.
Moles?
Yeah, but they touch something that you said eat, not to eat in about 10 milliseconds. Mm-hmm.
Have you heard of sea pigs?
Huh?
Sea pigs, these little urchin things that crawl around on the floor of the ocean. And they sap up things like in only a couple of milliseconds off the sea floor, but they have no eyes.
No, couple of milliseconds, come on. A couple of milliseconds, impossible. No. It's maybe 20 milliseconds is very fast. Yeah. 1 millisecond, it's...
Well, he's just speaking.
But the thing feels around...
He's a biologist.
Couple of milliseconds is not realistic. Your neuron fire is 2-3 milliseconds, right? So you cannot be faster than that. It's physical, you can't move with the speed. Yeah.
What is our reaction time, humans?
Depending on what?
The fastest thing, whatever it is.
Yeah, I think about 100 milliseconds. Maybe.
Oh, really?
Of course, we're inside some process may be happening faster, but we are very slow. Humans compare, say, monkeys are much faster. Because we're big. To see this reaction. Before your signal goes through the hand, you know, it takes some time. The monkeys, most of all, they react, do the same thing, you do the same, move faster than people. So this children are faster than adults, partly because they're short. I've forgotten what the speed is about. It's about 2 meters per second or something. It's very slow. And therefore, but some reaction in vision may be much faster, but you don't live aware of that.
I have a boring question in this discussion. So this discussion is interesting, but it's very vague.
Yeah.
Right. So, but yet the problems are clearly there and so on. So let's go move back to some very boring level where we actually know what we're talking about.
Yeah.
And then I move towards this vague area and stop just at the boundary and try to formulate any question which is precise, yet whose answer we don't know. So it might be really stupid, but just distinguish humans from worms. Or something.
Mathematical or non-mathematical question?
No, even just a kind of a precise. No, but just has to be precise, though. I mean, something precise, maybe very banal and not.
No. Precise
but
question.
But whose answer doesn't.
How you generate sentences? So, what algorithm generates sentences? This is a very, very precise question.
Oh, how? So think of a mechanism that will mirror how a human generates sentences.
They imitate a conversation which we have. So you receive an input, how you absorb it, or universal algorithm doing that. It's universal, of course, not attached to the situation, right? And then you react. So what is it, algorithm? There must be some simple algorithm we are not aware of. That's a basic question. They're very precise.
Just to imitate. No,
that's too complicated. Say it again.
It's what imitated know what it means, yeah? Because you can say that the question might be not just imitation, because the question abstractly might be beyond. Imagine you have an algorithm which has memory of itself 2 to the 10 of universe. You can imagine this, but this is kind of not an answer. It might be algorithm which is executable in the time space regime which we observe. Right? If it's not executable, then just it's meaningless. So all these models, what artificial intelligence, by the way, what Penrose says or other people, absurd. They don't specify that the time special constraints. If they're out of there, it's absurd. Yeah, meaningless. You have to be morally attached. Well, some error maybe, but morally attached to what they are. happen in reality. And you know possibility of your brain at every moment you have about a million neurons working, they're firing rather rarely at the rate of some to a second, so much slower than any computer. So you function a very, very primitive computational scheme.
We can make analogies.
Yeah, and moreover, they go in parallel, which is much less efficient than working in a sequence, right? So it is a very, very few possibilities which can be realized. Right? However, it works so well. How the hell?
What?
How the hell it works? So primitive. It might be very, very simple, very primitive system. All this we think about greatness of your brain, bullshit. It's very primitive piece of meat, yeah? And it's a very little part of us being involved in this conversation. How does it? Everything is very slow, everything is very primitive, very few neurons actually involved. Most of them, you know, they do digestion, breathing.
No, but we have all of our memory at our disposal.
What all?
All that we have.
How do you access to them?
Well,
they're slow memory, we don't know by
the way. Google does, I don't know, how does Google do it?
But Google have 1 million or 10 million computers, each work on this level of nanoseconds, and our brain work on tens of milliseconds. So it's take trillions of
times. Yeah, but I only read the first 10 of their million answers anyway. I only read the top of what they find. Maybe they find the top pretty quick.
No, they have huge memory. They remember all the information. They have a Markov chain and they have a more or less stationary measure. And you know from where to go to where. And then they organize the thing.
Well, we do it. The brain does it.
Yeah, but we do much more. But their machine cannot talk. What they do is very primitive, very nice thing, but still extremely primitive, which you can't describe. They've done it maybe 100 times better than you could do it, obviously, but it's obvious stuff that they've done. They only done 100 or 1,000 times better. For the brain, they're a trillion times better than we've done.
Wait, who does better, the brain or the computer?
With the painting on
what?
Of course, they search, the computer does
they
better.
They search better, but...
Any primitive, simple algorithm computer executes better. What we do, we can formulate what we do. That's the problem. We don't know what we do. We can describe it from outside. From inside, we have no idea what happens. We do it infinitely better than any computer, because the computer doesn't know what we do. The moment you explain to the computer what we do, it will do it billions of times better. But you don't know what it is. It's a problem to describe it. What happens inside? Logically, what the logical process generate what happens? We don't know them. And that's the issue. And it's logical. I mean, well, of course, you may say, well, there is something that I die, but it's a fantasy. It's all reason to expect it very simple. And we are just stupid, can't find it. And this is we are really stupid. This human brain is.
But that reminds me, so how many you said before, what analyzing what just our visual stuff is already, that's pretty precise.
Yeah.
And yet, we don't know how to explain that, right?
Describe it.
I mean, there's a precise thing. We get this certain, you could count how many pieces of information we have, right? In terms of just count the retina and the nerve cells and what we see, and then we're producing, I look like this in 1 millisecond, I know there are 15 people here, five girls, 10 boys.
It's illusion.
Huh?
No, it's illusion, by the way.
Huh?
It's a little bit of illusion. That's the bottom point. There are no illusions. You think you see what you see, you don't.
No, I know, but I mean, you could just glance, you can walk into this room, you know, somebody flips the light on, then flips it off, in that second you can get a huge amount of information about what's going on.
You close your eyes, it disappears.
Huh?
You close your eyes, information disappears. You have illusion, you have information.
I can start writing a book about it.
Look, the experiments. People come to the room, look, I know everything, and then you ask, have you seen, you know, 10, something huge there?
Okay.
And you don't see it. You know, they say,
I haven't like memorized it.
No, it's experiments with an ape.
No, but I could draw it.
No. You know the experiments with an ape? In the ape? That people, on the screen, you show people, they passing the ball one to another. And you have to count how many. And you look at the screen, yeah? They keep passing the ball.
Count how many what?
How many times the ball was switching hands. And then you show it for 30 seconds. And you count it. But then you didn't notice that during that there was a big ape jumping all over the screen. You don't notice.
Yeah, well, that's well, so what?
Because you only see what you want to see.
Yeah, right.
Right, and you may think you saw everything, and there are experiments. We have a blackboard on this on the wall. You come to the room, you see everything, and you ask, hey, what do you see on the wall? Nothing. You think at the moment you look, you have a feeling.
Your brain hasn't recorded it.
Yeah. No. It's unclear if you see it. Its brain could invent this. Many things which you see invented. You have some clues. And out of them, brain creates images. For example, you know, people being blind and they have surgery, they can't see anything. They have empty brain. you only see what already in the brain. Because most of coming to a visual center come from inside and from outside.
Oh, I see.
You only see clues.
The memory. Okay.
Yeah, it's dynamic memory. You create images. It's not just memories when you have, but you create images. And it's a very tricky process. And there was, you know, it's a model.
Well, that's the part that we don't know how to put in the computer. They have memory, but they don't know how to, we don't know how our brain organizes our
thoughts. How synthesize out of pattern? And we make mistakes, but we have reason to make mistakes. But without this mistake, it wouldn't be so efficient.
Right.
For that reason, we can very fast see what is relevant. Yeah, and when the rest of quite amusing to say experiments, how good even monkeys, not only human, recognize images of animals on the screen, and they just have to push the button when they see the animal, and instantaneously recognize animal, and even if it was artificial like a statue, they wouldn't react. Only a true animal. Mm. And it's fantastically how it works. They never saw it before. Mm. It's already some patterns are there. And they react to them. And consciously don't know, by the way.
But that's natural.
And moreover, when people do that, they are not aware they've seen this animal. They do it correctly, but they don't see it. Because it's very fast. On the rate of 300 milliseconds. It's blinking, and you do that. You're not aware what you're doing. Your hand is doing that, if you're trained. So it's unclear what you see and what you don't see. But anyway, there was a theory by Marx, and now it's completely disregarded. I forgot what it is, but it's kind of very naive. It was. Not bad, but quite naive. He was a great scientist on one hand, on the other hand, it was conceptual, not correct. And it's, what we do know, we don't have spatial. Spatial structure is not, essentially not recorded from the memory. It's only some digital patterns. But then out of this pattern, you construct the image, at least feeling of the image, when you see the real stuff. Okay, we don't know how to. But vision is more complicated. Vision, you know, takes, you know, half of your, more than half of your cortex. So, speech and things
like that. So sort of like we're cutting and pasting. We're writing essays like a bad student by cutting and pasting.
No, but you see, you compress. The point is you cut and you compress, and then you reconstruct. You have many different curves, projections, so to speak. And the issue of them compress a lot. And then out of them, you will make it back, using certain rules. And we don't know how to do it. And that's exactly the
same. Say it again. What?
So you have, you remember projection, from the very beginning, you have projection to a rational three-dimensional image. It's a lot of information being caused. However, you kind of have three-dimensional image, by the way, in our tricky point. But the way, another point, many people you ask, can you measure yourself swimming? Can you have a visual picture of yourself swimming? Right? You have.
Well, I changed the question from imagining myself swimming to picturing myself swimming.
Yeah, in the sea. Yeah. Imagine when the last time you were swimming in the sea. Can you imagine yourself swimming?
Yeah.
Yes, but you never saw yourself swimming.
What?
You never see yourself swimming.
Right.
That's the whole point. But you have all pictures. I also have a picture. Well,
you imagine other people swimming.
Yes. Yeah. Yourself. Well, but certainly your brain is picture of your swimming. So you have your image of the mirrors and that. Then you have your, so you can see your. If you remember, you can give an evidence on the court you saw yourself swimming. Yeah. So
it's completely. Would you see a video of yourself swimming?
Huh?
Would you see a picture or a video of yourself swimming?
Or Trump has big mirrors.
Maybe some people have this picture of themselves, but most of us don't. And at least I never saw myself as a picture, but you have imagined yourself swimming. And because you probably have lots of images of yourself, because you fix on yourself so much, your brain creates images of yourself. And not only that. But again, you have to forget.
Well, can you formulate a question like, imagine you give your computer a lot of photographs of things, and then you want your computer to start seeing like a human does, like that.
The point is language is so good.
Right?
Language is so good because there are easy tests. It's formalized. Language is already formal. And so you can communicate in a very formal way, and you can check ourselves if it goes well or not. Another very good problem, which is still amazingly solved, so DARPA doing something, how to make a program for running.
For what?
For running. Robots would run.
Ah.
And that's interesting, because maybe there was a progress, but when I look at all the papers, say, books, they're Newtonian mechanics, of course it's kind of obvious what should be done. and I'm terribly, it looks a rather easy question, however, because mechanical, of course. But as far as actually mechanical, there was a realized only recently that for stability, it's more important not your joints and your legs, but your spine. And this guy, which I mentioned in France, they made robots, which have no absolutely no electronics, only purely mechanical. And they work pretty well.
They walk.
If you push them, they won't, don't fall. Don't fall down. Because they have flexible spine. And this gives you tremendous stability in the body, for example. But apart from that, still you don't have, you cannot make freely running a robot. It's the way we do it.
MIT has a cheetah robot that runs. It goes pretty fast. It's a little cheetah robot. It's got four legs. It can run on random terrain. It runs on a...
That's the whole point. You run on a random terrain, you react. You have to see where you go. It's not just running. If you see a stone, you react, you behave differently.
They have it run on a treadmill, and then they randomly put in front of it like bars, and it has to jump over them,
yes.
And it has to sense them of a certain height to tell how high it
jumps. It's jumping, yeah.
And it jumps, but it'll only jump
on MIT.
It jumps over two bars. Like they put like two bars, or they put one bar. Sometimes it does a little jump, sometimes it does a big jump.
No, but in my view, it's still extremely, extremely simple problem. Yes, again, making it mechanically, I have no idea. But for programming it, it doesn't look to me that hard. In a way, except that you don't have to make a program. I see algorithms how to learn doing that. And then, again, based on general principles. So we have to take the difference. So my point was the following. Why children run? When it's much more quiet to sit down. What makes them run? Why they would hate to sit. And you know, by the way, this was observed that if you want the children at small age learn better, they never sit at the table.
Oh,
this is exactly this is a major obstacle for learning. They have to run and just go around and then just they learn. The moment they sit down, they're paralyzed, of course. It's exactly the point of that, because you put them not to learn, but to discipline them. And then you think you teach them. On the contrary, you want to dominate them. This is the whole problem with education. Teachers unconsciously try to dominate their children and therefore prevent them from learning. And they think they're educated.
He's going to get killed, this guy. I mean, you know, there's a lot of vested interest that you're...
No, that's sure. That's for sure. Like that.
It's obvious, actually.
Yeah, obvious.
We have little kids now.
Yeah,
you see it.
Yeah. Of course, I observe that.
Yeah, you observe it, yeah.
Another point, you know, about mathematics.
So why do they want to run? What's your, I mean?
Okay, yeah, I'll say in a second. Yes, why would you prefer to run? And about mathematicians, you know, maybe now it's not so much, but in my time, professors love to say that function is for every x there is a y, and just at a time. Therefore, if you have here zero and here one, it will be one function. Or for each rational number, from zero one to rational, why the same? They say it because to show I am professor, I can say, hey, you bullshit, and you have to accept that. The only reason why it's being said. Why is it such a bullshit?
Right.
It's nonsense. Yeah.
Well, some of it is.
It's absolutely nonsense. Just has some, you know, historical ground, you know, Warstrass, again, Kronke, da-da-da-da, but it's nonsense, you know. There is no definition of function to start with. Yeah. You don't know what function is. You can't say it to students. You're a professor, you're supposed to know. Right? What function is, you don't know what function is. Etc. And then you can say logically also, because map is in set theory. When functions have a structure with real line, why they have to say all that? And function, of course, not one-to-one, all good function multivalued, and they're not function, they're in distributions, etc. etc. And we have zero and one, they're two different functions. It's not one function. One is zero and other is one. They're two functions. Every idiot knows they're two functions. And so on. But it's only for that reason. That's the problem, yeah? Because we always tend to dominate. And running for the following reason, this abstract mathematical reason for that. Because from a certain point of view, which has to be formulated properly, it's again concerning entropy. When you run compared to state, your entropy goes down. So you one of the pattern of behavior, try to minimize your entropy. Minimize your entropy. So you do things which are complicated, which are not deviate from randomness. Of course, but it's very tricky. You have to formulate very carefully. Because again, when I speak about entropy, so what is small, what is big entropy? Say in physics already, you know that. it depends what you see, right? What your observable means. You can see in one kind of window one entropy, another entropy. For example, if you have a gas and then high energy stays invisible, right? There is no kind of quantum transition, but the entropy is there, right? Or now they say there is entropy in black holes because there is this fluctuation and this quantum vacuum, whatever.
Can somebody paraphrase what was just said?
Oh no, this is crazy. Huh? The point is that by doing something like pacing or fidgeting, you're reducing your entropy, and so you can focus on, right, on learning or doing whatever else it is you want to do.
How does moving reduce your entropy? Shouldn't that increase it? I mean, why does it go down?
You're reducing the number of sort of options of what you can do at any given moment.
Yeah, exactly.
By fidgeting.
Yeah, by doing anything, you're kind of repeating a
exactly
process.
Exactly, when you put on there, you reduce your... No, but this is...
No, say it all again, okay.
When you sit down, people sit there, they're uncomfortable. Sitting is not very natural position. It's very uncomfortable to sit for a long time, yeah, you know. It's a poor, you know, it's bad. Just...
A priori.
Yeah, it's a priori bad, yeah. And I'm saying it's only down to dominate children to say, I'm the boss, sit down.
No, but why is it better? He was explaining how why it's better when you're running around.
No, for children better. Running around, it's a natural state for children to run. And when you prevent them, they try to spend the energy just to...
But why is it better to be running around if you want to focus?
Now, because this is a process, it's, again, yes, first I say it informally, then I have discussed with me. So say entropy, but it's maybe better to say it the way I truly say it. It's more interesting to run than to sit, than to walk. It's more interesting to jump than to sit, or more interesting to sit than to lie. It's more interesting intrinsically, in some intrinsic terms for your brain. It's a more interesting process. And you have to explain what is meant interesting. So what is boring and what is not interesting. And then you have to say what kind of input you find most interesting. And the most interesting when you learn kind of maximal input. But then if you have, say, random sequence, it's zero input. Right, if everybody understand random sequence, zero information.
Random sequence, what?
If you have signals coming in,
random
sequence.
Random sequence.
Yeah, it's zero information. It's not big entropy. It's entropy may be big, but despite definition you have, it is zero information. You learn nothing from it, almost nothing. Almost as little as from the constant sequence. And you only learn from certain particular patterns, and that's very tricky to say what they are. That's one of the difficulties. You don't exactly know what. And when you run, you have much more input, of interesting input, for your nervous system, abstract without understanding you run. And if you kind of lie down, you learn nothing. And that's the point. And then the children are compelled to run. When you force them not to run, of course they spend the energy not to run, and say how they can learn. I mean, if you hit on the nails, you cannot learn much.
When you're thinking about math, don't you do it sometimes when you're lying down?
Hmm? Well, no, you may lie down, of course, but I'm not a child. Yeah, certainly my learning a long time ago. Yeah.
Huh?
Active learning stopped a long time ago in our age. Yeah, we don't learn much. But children learn a lot. And running is, they learn something about the internal functioning of their body, which is kind of crucial. And compelled to do that.
She was asking whether it's related to the entropy.
It's not naive entropy. You have to be very careful what you call entropy. Because input are highly heterogeneous. So you can't say entropy in the usual terms, PI, KI, because there's no probabilities. But in examples, you can see what more informative and less informative. So you want to maximize a reaction to your behavior, right? And if you run, you certainly do something and you see this something happens. If you do nothing, nothing happens. On one hand, of course, you have maximal information about happening. If you do nothing, nothing happens. You think you know maximal. No. You want to have maximal input. But this input will be also maximally controlled. It's somewhat in a contradiction. So this parameter of adjustment, which you can try to balance. So you want to learn, speak to somebody, right? You don't want exactly to know the response. Right, but you want to learn maximum from response. The response completely unrelated to what you say, don't like it. Right? Or if you say something exactly what you also don't want. But there is some balance. So you want to kind of control a situation, but for the purpose to extract your maximum information. And that's kind of, you can say, minimize the entropy. Right? And entropy will be opposite. And then if you properly formalize it for different inputs, then you can model and say how the system works without understanding what it does. Most have no idea what it does, just has signals. Only the only parameter it has is just entropy profile. how much it can predict on the base what was going on there, and how much by the action and can change this input. And what is input in material? And only on the base of that, you have to make a problem. And these guys were doing this more or less in France, is making these robots, but they didn't go fast. It's very difficult to implement it when it's got more and more elaborate behavior. Their behavior of their robots arrived at the level maybe of babies of 3-4 months. And they did behave, by universal program, arrive at this level. But then how to go beyond it's very unclear. And that's the issue.
They can make a 3 or 4 month old baby robot?
Yes, right.
Really?
Right. Exactly.
No, I'm not joking. I mean, that has definite, if you're a parent, I've had six. I've watched them closely.
Yeah, exactly.
I was watching my six-year-old son once, and I got the idea I could figure out how the brain was working because he would go like this. And he would come back here, tune this one, and he'd try this one again. You know, it was definite pattern of learning. You know,
it was like 6 months.
6 months.
6 months, yes.
Six months, yeah.
Right,
it was
right.
Definite.
So, yes.
And I was feeling I could write Piaget a letter about what's going on, you know?
No, can see it, but understand intrinsically what it gives you. Huh? To model it, it's not so easy.
No, but I mean, it was clear there was a structure.
Yeah, sure.
A definite structure.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. There is structure, but it's more and more elaborate. With age, it's much harder to model it after that.
I mean, my niece runs around crazy, little girl.
Yeah.
But she's not calculating entropies.
No. They're not playing. They're working.
They're definitely calculating. I don't think they're actually calculating, though.
No, but calculating
the wrong stuff out.
No, calculating
how it works.
What do you mean by word calculation?
You said you had a very precise reason why children run, and you gave a discussion about entropy and minimizing, I guess.
Right. Exactly.
But it's not as though we have an awareness that we minimize entropy.
Of course, we have no awareness. Of course, no awareness of that. Of
just
course,
feels
no awareness. And nothing. You have awareness more or less than probably 100% of mental processes, because you have simultaneously functioning, say, 1 million neurons. So you have probably 10,000 channels working simultaneously at the rate of 20-30 milliseconds. What you have perceived is just 1 out of 10,000. So what? Of course, you have no idea what happened then. Almost nothing can happen there. You just have no abilities to do that. You have one unit of information every maybe 30 milliseconds, and you produce 10,000 of them. So what you know nothing what happens in your brain. No idea how we can do it, because it's a parallel system. You know it is absolutely parallel. I'm saying very few neurons, several millions, but millions is a lot for our perception.
But why would a system want to reduce entropy?
No, I can say it's a very simple reason. You need universal mechanism which applies to everything. The point is, basically, it's observed in nature. Let me give an example, give some examples. A universal mechanism can be adapted to this situation, evolution, that has no kind of this smartness. It's adapted, it's a very simple mechanism applicable to everything. And let me give an example, and this was discovered first of them, by I think one of the great minds of the last century, and most nobody knows him. And this, I think, is tremendous shame, called Spalding. Yeah, you never heard of
him? Who?
Spalding.
Spalding?
Yeah, Spalding.
He invented the tennis ball. Different ball.
There's no U?
No.
A U?
Spalding.
That's right.
Yes, Spalding. And he was a contemporary of Darwin.
Of Darwin,
yeah. I think he was much brighter than these guys. He died young. He was poor, like Darwin, so he died young. And he experimentally discovered that there are some universal pattern behavior of animals. He studied the animals. And particularly found what is called imprinting. Now imprinting is shared his name Lawrence. He took it from his professor and professor from somebody else, and this was come from Pauli, about 100 years prior to that. And this, I think, was the major discovery in psychology. Psychologists hate him because, of course, it's they're not important from their point of view. I spoke to some of them, and they and he discovers a particular imprinting, and so is the idea of imprinting. How a little baby recognizes his mother.
What?
A little baby, chicken or duckling, recognizes who mother is. Very complicated stuff, and very simple.
First thing he sees is
that,
mother.
No, the first moving object.
Hmm?
First moving object.
Yeah.
And so you have an idea of motion, and then there was another similar phenomenon discovered by Tinbergen, that how a little baby animal recognizes predator. So there are shadows of birds. Predator birds are innocuous. There is a geese flying or there is a hawk flying. And if there is a hawk, it runs away. In geese, it doesn't. How? How it knows? Who is who? He can distinguish shapes, but he don't know what shape
the
is what.
The frequency of flapping the wings?
No. No,
do they count the number or whether it's one or more?
No. It's one.
Yeah, hawks are kind of unit.
Right. Yeah. No, the point is, those which are frequent.
What?
Those which are frequent, you ignore. And which are rare, you run away. So if it's the first time, you run away from everything. But then you get used to it. Mm-hmm. And this is a mechanism we have to understand.
It's very simple, yeah.
Yeah, very simple, exactly. This out of which our thinking is made also. It's a very simple thing. And that what makes all this making for running or whatever. And
this doesn't explain you, though. This doesn't explain you, though.
It does. The whole thing. It explains everybody.
You get it? You get it, right?
It explains everybody. We are exactly made out of this simple stuff. Yeah. There's nothing fancy, no intuition, nothing. It's very primitive stuff.
Yeah, but we're all going along with these professors' theories, and you're not. That's what I'm saying.
No, this is a very sad story. Yeah, he died. I read some of him his years and very brilliant.
He discovered this thing about the first moving object.
Yes, right. And then it was like everybody sat into Lawrence, which was not a year, but he didn't discover it. And it was, it was.
The predator is the unusual thing, so to speak.
Yeah.
That's a very simple principle.
So. Yeah, very, very simple, yeah, but it's completely forgotten. Nobody knew about it, and then it was.
Oh, he also. Explain that, the predator thing?
No. This is a Tim Berger. I don't think he is. Okay. He studied quite a bit. Animals, he just made some general principle, predate and prey, how they react, and just was really very smart guy. And he died. And this was happening systematically at that time. Yeah, all kind of old people, like very rich people like Darwin could exist as a gentleman, and poor people just couldn't make sense. Yeah. Or they were bought, like Wallace was bought by Darwin.
What?
Wallace. We discovered simultaneously with Darwin the evolution. It was bought by Darwin. Darwin gave him position, he shut up. And that was it.
Excuse me. If you consider the cumulative entropy, does it change it?
No, but entropy means metaphorically understood entropy. It's not entropy in the sense of PL or PI.
No,
it's something which is you read just formally from a sequence of signals. Right? And that's how you look at the signals and just their relative frequency, how they change and their behavior, and that's all you have. And on the basis of that, you produce algorithms. And they're universal for all kinds of animals. We have them from the time immemorial. And then they kind of, some reason, they were kind of rearranged, and so we have some conjecture what happened in the human brain. There was some circle, kind of some cycles being created, and then it started working. But exactly as of course
this works.
Yeah. So there was some circle was closed. It was more and more complicated, then it caught his tail and started turning around. And we developed what we have. But again,
discovered Russell's paradox.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's Russell's paradox, exactly. Yeah, no, it's all that happened.
Made that up.
And but again the question is how to model it mathematically. And they just say, have some, I can say some, I know, I guess some ingredients which are there. But, so already mathematically, I have kind of interesting, quite formal questions related to that. So the main mechanism, I think, mathematically is very simple and very powerful, is what is called B clustering. This is one of these pure mathematical mechanisms, which is the key to many things in the mind. And I think
B
clustering.
B
clustering.
A, B, C, B.
Twice, meaning B meaning for two.
Oh, B, B.
Two-fold clustering. The co-clustering.
Oh, B, B, I.
B, I, or co-clustering. And this is the following thing, which is, so you have a matrix, you say, something like 10,000 by 10,000 matrix, which is big.
We have that?
They're not imagine. No, this mathematical kind of mathematical equation. Exactly, type of mathematics which is not exactly mathematics. 1,000, 10,000, 100,000 by 100,000. It's important to have numbers, otherwise meaningless. So the number of entries will be about 10 billion. Yeah?
1,000 times 10,000 is a million. 10 billion. 10 million.
No, 100,000 by 100,000. So it will be 10 billion. It's a big measure. And see, 100,000 is a small number. But square of that is a big number. And that's one of the points.
So this 100 actually, billion.
Huh?
100 million.
No, 100,000 by
100,000.
No, 100,000. 10 billion. And 10 billion is a pretty big number. So it may be even million by million.
Well, 10 billion. Yeah.
Trillion. Million is still a small number. But after billion, becomes, they become big, right? For your brain to handle. Because you see, your life contains about 3 billion seconds, right?
Jesus.
A billion is
a sounds
like a lot,
though.
It's but million is only about 2 weeks. Right? So it's incomparable. Million is a small number, billion is big. A trillion is beyond you. So million is okay, million squared beyond you. So let's be able to simplify to speak, say million by million metrics. So it's about trillion entries. And you know, it's partly filled. So
what?
It is filled by in some places.
Oh, the matrix is kind of filled with information.
Yeah, it may be black or white, and some of them are really filled. And you have, say, it's million by million, say, matrix, and say it have, you know, 10 million entries. Right? And you want to know what in other places.
What?
And you want to know what's happening in other places which are not filled. So this information you receive from the language. And then you want to make conclusion in a new situation. Of course, you cannot go through all of them, it's trillion, but any particular spot you want to know. How to do that? So at what point, what solution? Actually, I believe it is.
Does a particular spot have meaning?
No, this is just, you do have this correlation. Some verse, groups of verse come close together, often. And you have those come, and those we met, you know they don't come. And some
it's a correlation matrix.
It's a correlation matrix. Now you have a new configuration. You want to know it come together or not. So how to do that? And this is obvious solution. But exactly this is some point which is not quite mathematical. Because it will work in the real world, or it may not work. And it sometimes works. But it will not apply to everything. It will not universal algorithm apply to everything, because everything is junk. It's not supposed to work for junk data. But for data coming from the real world, they're structural and they do work. And it's very simple. And you say, aha, we reduce this matrix, which has 10 billion entries, to smaller matrix, which is really million by million. It actually means that there are maps from this entries to the column, from the column to one and the column to another. And then your big matrix is a pullback under this map of a small matrix. And this your 10 by 10 million already fills the small matrix. Therefore, you know a small matrix will pull back, and your computation only in the right order of million, because to map million to thousand is the same as to million to 0 or 1. Yeah, in the image, entropy doesn't grow, it's just a small factor. Therefore, you can compute easily this map, if you compute these maps from one to another, and have this matrix. So you need only so many millions bit of information, which is we can learn, and you can reconstruct trillion matrix.
And where do you get this matrix in the map? Huh? Where do you get this matrix in the map? Where do you get it?
What do you mean?
The quotient matrix.
In your head. Your memory, in your head, you have a space.
You're born with it.
Yeah. The question is how to make it, of course. This is an NP problem, of course. If you want to do that, even if possible, it's NP problems. Even if the deduction is possible. Well, I didn't prove it, but it's clearly a very hard problem. But if you look at the real world, this is what's happening, and I give you an example. And this is not my invention. Actually, I'm curious who first invented that. People in linguistics and by informatics, we give it terminology, I'm not aware, whether one or another, maybe now they're aware. And I learned it actually by informatics. But in linguistics, they use it for classifying, and this is simultaneously, so it's also simultaneously classify your entries. So
what?
You have classify your entries. So you have experiments and you have outcomes.
Oh.
And you classify your kind of experiment, apply for animals to treat and what the tests of them give. Yeah? You have millions of them and now you have 1,000. And so, you can classify parts of speech. And people use this for classifying parts of speech, saying who comes together. So without understanding what they are, you observe, you classify them, you don't give the name. And then they found out that in English, the particles "e" and "the" were in different groups, but "the" was together with "his".
Which two are different, which two are
together? "E" and "the".
"E" and "the"?
Yeah, very different. But "his" was together with "the".
"They"?
Yeah.
Yeah, but I know.
And
I know
linguists are very unhappy.
If you want to refer to a person and you don't want to reveal the sex of the person, you say "they".
No. But this is not the point. This, of course, as an English
it's used
speaking,
a lot.
As a speaking English, you don't realize the problem because you say different groups, and he is in the same group, and this is different.
Just
the, not they.
No, it's
the. Oh, I see. The and his or.
Yeah.
And for English.
I mean, they're used in a particular way,
yeah,
similar way.
No, this
that's one's an article. One's a pronoun. No, that's
no, no, no. You classify all parts exactly, but you forget all bullshit. You look classify words, forget the meaning. That's
okay,
the whole point.
See which.
You forget the meaning.
See the logical correlation.
You see, not logical. See, come close together for me. You observe, and then this, and this will be in the same. After making factorization, this will come to go to the same group, and this go much further. Why?
What? They go what?
This further. This is not in the same group. And then English argument.
But can't we explain that? I mean, those two are kind of specific. No. They're more they're in specific terms of that.
No, no.
Tell me the theorem. Tell me a theorem. That's completely different. Give me his car.
Right.
Give me a car. Those are
sure. But for me, for not English speakers, exactly how you decide which to use. I see where I can put his. Yeah. And this for any people learning English is would be like that. But then, after 10 years later, historical linguists realize they have different history. They're linguistically different. They're artificially brought together. They're not. They go. They seem to the same part of speech. They're not the same. Like the words to be in the past and the common in the present, they're different words. They used to be different words, right? I am, I wasn't, just different concepts. And now it become connected with this, historically and so. And so this works better. And this is the only way to, in my view, this is how you should analyze everything. You forget their meaning. You don't know what meaning is. It's illusion. Meaning is illusion.
What do you remember? What do you notice? If you want to forget their meaning.
Ah, yes, these are interchangeable. They're much more.
But how do you measure that? Just look at.
My experience, what I remember, what Frank says is, I remember, I can replace it and see it's okay. Mm-hmm. At the day and I'm not.
Or just look at all the sentences.
Yeah, but this is exactly what the clustering does. It's roughly two things brought together if they have many common friends. And the point is, you have very weak concepts of common. This makes it much stronger by this process. You see, it's a self-improving process. And I have a very weak concept of type thing being similar. Now, say they're strongly similar, they have many weakly similar kind of neighbors. Mm-hmm. And this is a self kind of exactly how learning should go. Yeah. Right? You start with a very rough, very vague kind of ideas, but then iterated, and you become a fixed point of some transformation. It's another point of
learning. It's like your argument. M squared equals M. Take a high power.
Yeah, but this is iterate, yeah. This you don't have to iterate. But here you actually iterate. And this is the one, and the big clustering in there. But that's, of course.
Well, that's what bi-cluster is?
Yeah. So you see how things are related, divide them in groups according to how they relate to members of another group. So you know nothing about each of them. But knowing their relation, you can classify them. Mm-hmm. And this is what you know. You know things as the same or not. And this is second level, because you start with a very primitive idea of similarity, and then you come to the final idea. And then there is opposite process. How to know any kind of similarity. Apparently, here already on the neuronal level, you have clear idea of equality on elementary level. So they kept in the same neuron, or in the identical neurons. And so they have some feature by which you can then. It's an equality of features which makes a priori very rough comparison. And then there are many of them, and then you come to the next level. So this hierarchical kind of memory.
What is the next level?
Then you start classifying relations. So you know they're related by some mechanism, and then you classify this mechanism, I guess. And that's what makes human different from other animals. You can operate on this level, I guess so. But it's very hard to do, because when you start, I'm trying to formalize it, it's become unformalizable. I mean,
the first thing would explain why a child could start saying sentences that are reasonable, because he or she repeats the ones that are common. But it wouldn't explain why they can start substituting and creating their own sentences that are very unusual but are correct.
Yeah.
You know, so that's also amazing.
It's absolutely the whole, the way it works, and it works in here, because it's pure nonsense and oops, it become coherent language at some moment. And of course you cannot, I think the process computation is so complicated, you can't have it in your head. You have to make a computer, but you have to invent intelligent problems which we can experiment, but I'm unable to do that. But first you have to imagine kind of reasonable problems, which also I don't know exactly how to do.
I lost a pen that my wife gave me with my first child, and And then where was the pen? And I was couldn't find it, and I was in a bad position. And the daughter, who just learned to speak, said, "Daddy's a naughty boy for losting mommy's present." You know, that's clearly her unique sentence, right? From losting mommy's present.
So, I have a question. You said that there was like 10,000 channels that come, so there's some small child. They have 10,000 channels that are feeding information into them, or whatever the state is.
Right.
And there's...
It's internal channels. Internal
channels, yeah.
External is not so many.
Sure. And every 30 milliseconds, they receive like a blast of information. So they've got sort of like this 10,000 entry vector, and then every 30 milliseconds there's one of these things, and it's just going off into time. How does this child differentiate between this string of vectors?
What do you mean child? Wait. Whom you call the child? There is no child. In this game, there is no child. It's an illusion.
Human.
Is illusion. There's only these channels. There is no child.
All right, there's no child, just these channels. Okay.
No, channels in and channel out. And that's it. There's no, it's exactly
this
the wrong
like
idea.
A
it's exactly the standard mistake. There's no you, no him, nothing. There are only these channels. So it's meaningless symbols, in and out. They have no meaning. Forget the meaning. They have to operate with them, but the brain has no idea of meaning, right? Signals come, all it knows about the signals, how they're similar, how they correlated, that's all. There is nothing else. Everything else is a construct of your kind of personality, which is not there.
Is there an observer of this sequence?
No.
There's no observer.
No. Who observes? Who observes?
Well, how do you make the information out of the information that's coming? Or clearly like a child listens to...
No, but this is exactly wrong. Clearly it's wrong. You say clearly because you can't explain it. You say clearly because it's illusion. There's nothing with that.
But children do learn how to talk.
Mm-hmm. No, but they will forget about that. They'll be thinking about functioning of your mind, not about what children do. They also digest, they have bacteria running in them,
sure.
They breathe, they smell, they do many things, they're material. It's completely, they have to forget about that whole point.
You have to forget about it,
it's a material, it exactly blocks your mind. This exactly all this idea blocks your mind.
Okay.
That's what I'm saying, that blocks your mind.
The what, Baba?
Blocks your mind. Having all this in your mind, exactly what prevents you from right thinking. That's exactly what distorts people thinking like you. They all have this idea, it's wrong. This is why we fail. It's exactly so following this race, and they fail completely because they're imitating behavior, having images before them. They try to project it to them, but it's wrong. But if you see how drastically they fail, everybody, exactly having that idea. You can forget about that, forget everything you know. You think in these abstract terms.
No, maybe I'm wrong, of course, but that's my point.
That's conjecture, because you know failure was fantastic. Yeah. So I may be wrong, but the other guys, everybody else wrong for sure. That's the one point, yeah.
So is anyone aware of their own sequence?
No, certainly not.
Everyone's aware of their what?
Is anyone aware? Like,
no, of course
you're
not
aware
of
their
own
sequence. Of your own what?
Sequence.
What sequence?
So this 10,000 vectors, 10,000 entries.
No, when you fall asleep, you're aware of something.
No, but moreover, this mechanism, let me say something else.
Sure.
This mechanism, where it happens, it is a machine. And I believe it's blocked, for Eldar, at least creatures, blocks us for good reason from the rest of your mind. For children, it may be partly off. The moment you start kind of providing for yourself, especially when you're adult, you have to find your food, you have to find your mating partner and everything, then you do practical things. And then things will kill you. If you have, like Ramanujan, who this was open, and he wouldn't survive in normal society. People like him don't survive, they don't give their genes. Property of that being open, so this machine coming to the visibility would be completely kind of detrimental for your existence, for your survival. Therefore, it's blocked. Children don't provide for themselves. They don't do nothing. So they play. And in the play, you see manifestation of this mechanism. Right? So they do irrational things. It's another point, of course, not understood about human, which is very confusing. Usually people think people human are rational. On the contrary, humans, a major feature of human being irrational. Cockroaches are rational. Human are not.
How do you differentiate rational and irrational?
Okay, because cockroach would never do purposeful assumption against its own survival. Humans do it all the time, right? Like doing mathematics.
Cockroaches every now and then will just randomly stand out in the middle of the sidewalk or the middle of the kitchen.
They can make a mistake. They can make a mistake.
They go out in the dark and they turn the light on.
Of course, they have limitation of what they do right or wrong. Of course, the situation has changed. But they don't do purposefully going to Everest, and to fall down, or something like that, And we do this all the time. It's part of life.
They don't go skydiving.
Yeah, of course, absolutely. But we do lots of things, all art, right? All we do, kind of. Flowers, it's all irrational, right? Music, you know, mathematics, it's irrational. Yeah. And this is exactly because this machine which we have internal, much more powerful, and goes a little bit outside. But if it goes showing itself too much, you die. Yeah. If you start doing mathematics when you have, you know, in a primitive society and there are animals running to eat you, yeah, it's better not to do much of mathematics. Yeah, exactly. So it was not evolved. So this prophecy is not evolved. This is what I'm saying. It might be very primitive because it didn't evolve. It's just there because it was so primitive. What we have as a power of our mind. It did not evolve. It's not good for us. Right? It would kill us if we were on the surface. For children, it's okay. But then it disappears. When you have to learn a lot, so it can open. And then you don't learn much, and so it closes up and you prevent it. It's like in your cells, you have mitochondria. And if they produce energy, but they have blocked from the rest of the cell because it can destroy it by products. It's the same there. It's part which is hidden from you for good reason. You're not supposed to know it. And then you have illusion of your mind, just feel good, etc. If you know that, you look like a revolution, but not a happy person, in a way, I guess. And this, there are many people like that, I guess, like him. Yeah? They're not survival types. We have like Law for Gabriel, yeah, they do. They're not survival types. They have a direct kind of access to the interior of their brain. Right? You agree, yeah, something very remarkable. We see these people and they're rare. There's something broken in them, you know. Very somewhat broken. And they're kind of maybe geniuses, but they're not survival.
Does everybody here know who Alpha Gabber is?
No.
Some of you do? Mm-hmm. Well, we had a lot of experience with him. Before I had experience, Barry Mazur described him as he may be the foremost problem solver in the world today. In fact, he may be the best problem solver that has ever been alive for all time. In fact, he may be the best problem solver that will ever be alive. It's sort of the most superlative thing you could say. And then we could see him at IHES. So for example, one day Nick Katz came in and said, I know why the first class in the metro is more expensive. And they said, and we all said, why? He said, because it goes faster. Now see, the joke is, the first class and the regular class are on the same train. Well, Offer didn't laugh. And about 10 minutes later, he says, I can prove that that's wrong. Anyway, it took him a long time to deal with that. On the other hand, if you would ask a math question at T, he would start analyzing the sentence that you said, all the words in it, and make it precise. It would start changing. About half the time, the question would just disappear into something banal and obvious.
Or wrong.
It would just his direct analysis would solve the question. Or finally, it would converge to a meaningful question that wasn't immediately true. Then he would sort of walk once around the tea table and usually give the answer. Every so often, it would be the next day. Am I glad?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Huh? Not exactly. Yeah.
And what's funny is, I recently asked him something about, you know, this analytic periodic functions, and I first asked all experts.
Yeah.
And they said, oh, it's so complicated. And then I asked Aber, and he next day he gave me just one sentence.
Yeah.
And they said, well, I understood it. Yeah. And you know, the question of an analytic periodic function, why its expansion at any point, the conversion determines the whole function. And you know, all these people, they're writing textbooks, they couldn't answer me.
Really? Yeah. Is that true, though?
Yeah, sure, it's true. Of course, he explained to me, algebra. I even written somewhere, and he did some generalization of that. And it is kind of obvious, if you know, in right terms. And when he'd answer, he'd smile, he's so happy. Yeah. When he asks,
this is how he communicates with human race.
Yeah.
Although once we went to dinner in Orsay late at night in a car, and we parked the car in front of the police station, and as we got out of the car, someone was worried about the police giving us a ticket, and the officer said, they'll never think of looking for it there. That's a joke. That's a human joke. And I thought, wow, officer is, this is like 10 years later.
Yeah.
He's sort of slowly learning how to. Anyway, so he has access to this mathematical...
It is an internal machine, yeah.
Yeah.
which and then like Ramanujan in a different way though.
Yeah.
And but we are protected from that. We don't have access.
But he, but I understand what he's doing. I can't do it, but I can see he's just totally being literal and using all of his information about math, but he's just making it explicit and very honest and transparent, no jargon, no nothing. You know, very honest, very transparent.
Yeah, but it's easier to say and understand.
Yeah, right. No, but I see what he's doing.
Yeah, it's an illusion.
I can't imitate it.
Exactly.
Well, I try.
That's the whole point, yeah. You see everything what you do about
ourselves. Don't let my students use words. Yeah, they can't use proper nouns or anything like that.
I thought Ramanujan, when people asked him like how he did this, he said he dreamt it and God appeared to him. Yeah.
Actually, Maxwell was saying something of this similar kind of himself. Maxwell. He had a feeling that not him, but something else behind him was doing what he was doing.
Uh-huh.
And I think it's true about everybody. What we do, we don't know what to do. Something does for us, yeah.
Right.
And these people are doing it better than ourselves, but it's unclear again whether it was advantage or it was some defect in the blocking of this path. So my conjecture is exactly this. We are more or less all equal in that. But we have defects, may be broken here and there. Because you cannot, you know, have this thing so complicated with so much illegal. But break it's easy. Create new is difficult.
But I read a one-page essay of yours where you said that anyone's unconscious mind is 100,000 times better in computing and doing mathematical patterns than the greatest mathematician of all time with their conscious mind.
Right, no, the thing is that you make a visual image of the world.
What?
Creating the vision of the world, yeah, it's incredibly complicated.
The fact that everybody could do that, so we're great unconscious mathematicians for seeing patterns.
Or how you run, it's very difficult to make a problem to solve.
Sort of reassuring, actually.
And it happened, I couldn't reconstruct it, I read it, but then I couldn't find the internet. It was somebody, some South American man, who was actually mentally deficient, and then he was in an accident, brain injury, and he became absolutely fantastic painter.
Wow.
And he was painting animals, and I saw this picture, but then I couldn't find him again on the internet, his name.
Oh.
And I found similar cases, but this particular case I couldn't find. And painting were really funny, extremely non-trivial paintings, yeah.
With animals?
Of animals, yeah, exactly with animals.
I've seen an example of this. There's some office I went to and there were paintings on the wall, and the maid's husband had been very ill or had an accident and then something happened, and afterwards he was able to paint, and he painted these, I remember he had a painting of these two zebras touching their nose, and it was extremely evocative, incredible paintings of animals. Couldn't be the same guy.
Yeah, maybe the same person. Yeah, but
I could find out. It's hard to remember this.
So I think potentially lots of things happen hidden in the mind, and just we protect from it. It may be broken, and then it comes. I think mathematicians, we all have a little leakage.
A little what?
Leakage. Yes. Leakage. Yes. Yeah. From the inside to outside, which we use. And so it's very difficult for psychologists, for anybody, it's impossible to study, because first they have to know mathematics. I think it's easier than language, because we are learn mathematics at later stage.
Who?
Mathematics, right?
Yeah.
So just learning languages is what happens when it's a child. You can't imagine, you can't explain how it happens. With mathematics, we learn it at later stage, and you see how it can change under this learning, right? You observe it. So you have a little bit more input. But of course, also like with language, it's a slow process. Right? The result of learning happens maybe seen in years afterwards. So it's many, many things probably happening in your head. Yeah, you don't know what that. And then there are this much more diversity also. And that's also useful. Like people like Offa Gabor or Ramanujan, the exception cases. And this exception, I'm more telling you, this is exactly one of the points about statistics. Exception cases more significant than common cases. And that's one thing about.
What do you mean, more significant?
Let me give another example. If you want to understand how stars are, the most important are explosion of supernovas. And this happens observable about once in 500 years. And you can say, forget about that, the statistical works. Then you know nothing about stuff. Because this...
So the only reason we see them today is they're coming in, no, information is coming in from far away.
No, now we see them in the outer galaxy, but those observable from the Earth, the last was about 300 years ago, or 400 years ago. And the number of records in history were about 5 of supernovas. And but they tell you more about stars than just usual stars, because they have this much more, getting much more information. And the fact they're rare means nothing. Yeah, could mean rare. It is a heterogeneous system.
Oh, I see.
And applying to this statistic, absurd. Right? So you can use them, but you have to understand. You have divided into homogeneous blocks. So this is what I'm saying. Your probability is not a number, but some organized structure where numbers play some role, but not the only kind of minor role. More importantly, how it's divided into groups. And the same, these people, they collect superstars, yeah, the supernovas, like Ramanujan. And they give light fantastic we can't learn from anywhere else. And you have to understand it. And psychologists, of course, never look at that because it just, they cannot understand it. We have to understand exactly what they've done, which is not so easy. How to understand, know a little bit of history and just...
Well, why can't you could read Shakespeare or something?
Well, with Shakespeare, it's slightly different because too much immersion into human culture. Human culture, once it blocks your vision, is it right? Exactly what blocks your vision, human culture. And when it manifests in the culture, in this respect, probably music is better. But
no, but I mean, obviously the child of the brain is adapted to learn as much about human culture
absolutely.
As quickly as possible for survival. That's how the brain works.
Absolutely, absolutely. But that's make a kind of... external kind of a covering which prevents you seeing from through it. In our culture exactly what prevents you from seeing things like that. And again, for me, it's a fantastic example of the history of evolution theory, which, because if you look at the basic principle of evolution, selection is obvious for every idiot, yeah, once being said. It was not said only because it's blocked on the mind. It's not kind of genius of Darwin, it's idiocy of the surroundings which makes it so it's very different from the discoveries in physics. The Newton law, as an incredible, right, complicated today it was 500 years ago. See how you can do that. Imagine there is acceleration, all these new concepts. Evolution is an exponential function. Any idiot would understand it. I mean, understand what numbers are. But it was...
but if I think about the examples that you have said today that I kind of see, like the idea of something or other, noticing the hawk versus the geese.
Yeah.
Simple thing, and then language that we're somehow recognizing familiar patterns.
Yes,
is a very important
absolutely.
Process.
Absolutely.
And maybe that's it.
Yeah. No. The question
I mean,
is
you have this mechanism for memorizing.
No, but you have to combine them. You have to iterate this process and tweak it. It's multi kind of. It's not even category. It's more like a multi category, like this operas. Yeah, it's many functions that come together. By the way, neural networks affect operas. Yeah. So what's the point of what?
Wait. What do you have to do besides being able to recognize and organize familiar patterns?
You have to organize the structure. Just division of patterns is very loose structure. Just graph. That's tree. And tree is trivial structure. It's necessary component, but it's trivial structure. Although this is just classification. And then you have to bring them together.
Well, but there are layers. I mean, a rough bit, just small amount of information.
Yeah.
And then another pattern which has a bit more information above it, and another one slightly different.
It's tree. But this is
all these projections are very important.
Yeah, but still, this is a tree. It's a very primitive structure, just classification.
Why isn't that enough?
No.
To explain everything.
No.
What can I explain?
But this you can do. This is trivial. You can imagine.
I know. Nevertheless,
give me this structure, and you do nothing with this. People believe this. You know, in passaging very much, these neural networks that are indeed they can classify and recognize patterns. It's not sufficient. You have to recognize patterns in way being pattern being recognized. You kind of remember mechanism by which you recognize this pattern, and this become new pattern is classified again. See, and this subsequently that happens. You classify.
You mean the learning mechanism.
Yeah, and this is a super, and this, you know what happens, you just you learn one thing and automatically you have another thing. For example, you know, you write from left to right with these hands, but you almost everywhere you can write this way. You know that? You don't have to do it. You have, it's like close your eyes and you start writing. And you recognize it by your handwriting. First, of course, you will be a little bit awkward, but then you can do it very fast. Or, you know, people learn to write. Everybody, you write on the paper, but then we write on the blackboard. It's the same thing. How the hell? Completely different.
So no, but,
it means there are universal things we learn. And then there are little manifestations which are much easier to implement. And what are these universal? You even can write with your leg, you know, and it will be recognizable by your handwriting.
Okay, so when the information is coming in and you're trying to categorize these things in different patterns of similar types and whatnot, how do you know the information that's coming in is not just purely random?
Oh, but you don't know. If it's purely random, you die. If purely random comes, you start doing mechanism, you're just dead. And that's it. You don't know, you don't care.
So
you don't see it. You don't notice it.
Yeah, no, it's nothing. So you die. Nothing happens. So yeah, if you have, you try to run out of
it's like a lightning bolt. Purely random information comes in and just...
You can't, you die. So, your brain become, you know, junk. Poop, you die.
Huh.
It's the same, you take a poison. You have to eat good food. And your boy recognizes good food, you get cheating, you gave poison, you die. That's it. So...
Wouldn't you get a little bit of poison a lot over a long period, or like a little bit of poison for a long period of time, and then develop an immunity? Like, could I take in a little bit of random information over a
you
long
don't
period
develop. Who said about immunity? Who said about immunity?
No.
So, there is no immunity. When you take little poison for a long time, you just die slower. And that's it.
Professor, very often when people are talking about the theory of neural networks, which isn't really a thing yet, but kind of is, they formalize it in terms of certain manifold in a high-dimensional space.
Yes.
And on that manifold, yes, you have a way of walking,
yes,
which is minimizing some loss function. And are you suggesting then that in addition to something, some mechanism kind of like that, humans have a mechanism by which they recognize similar walks?
No, but of course there is neural networks do something, but they solve very primitive problems, and we don't know exactly how they work. They adjust it. You see, what you do is to present functions somewhere, and then use some gradient point, and it works so well because when you differentiate function, then you can kind of the number of derivatives can organize them, maybe not as many as it looks. Yeah, this is the point of the neural network, which is how many derivatives has function, many variables, and how to manipulate with them. So this kind of this technicality. And so they work very well, but anything would work in certain hands because you have multi-parametric machine for minimization, and you play, and eventually hit it. But it's not the point. Let me bring another very interesting example about statistics I learned recently, and I find very, very neat, which was done during the Second World War, when they were studying where to make airplanes stronger, and they look statistically there. They had airplanes where to put extra
armor.
Oh, yeah. And they had these airplanes, and they see where the holes of bullets were. And they had distribution of the bullets across the airplane. So where to put the armor?
They did the opposite.
Yeah, because where there is no holes.
What?
Where there is no holes. You put the armor where there is no holes. Because those didn't come back.
Ah, yeah.
So this about statistics, yeah. This was clever guy. I forgot his name. It was a particular guy who kind of figured it out. It was not as much what Milton thought it should be done. So there are kind of little simple things, yeah.
Which
doesn't come to your mind easily.
Robert McNamara?
Hmm?
Robert McNamara?
No, who done it?
Robert S. McNamara. He used to do statistical analysis on bombing runs over Europe.
No, it's not him. It's a different name. I might call it
an Englishman.
So he was much later. This is World War II, right?
Yeah, yes.
No, during World War II, he was in charge of a lot of these
displays. Yeah, he was the
He
one.
Was old enough for that?
Yeah,
no, he was young.
He was young. He signed up right out of college, and he went to, what is it called, a radar school, and he did intelligence stuff, and he did statistical analysis on effectivity of bombing runs.
Yeah, he would be about 80.
No, but this is not about bombing, but about receiving. No, this was a guy from academia purely. I don't remember his name, but it was another McNamara. It was not known. This name I know, but this was not known name to me.
No, but this is a good. Good guess. He's the right age and.
I'm pretty certain of him. Huh? I remember roughly the name, but it was the original.
He was one of the whiz kids and all that.
Yeah, he did a lot of things. He actually used seatbelts in cars and stuff like that.
Yeah, Detroit whiz kid. Yeah.
He was an academic.
He was also academic?
He was academic. He, I think he dropped out of his PhD program at like Yale or something like that. Like in economics, he dropped out.
I think I remember where I read it, because I read this and they made very funny.
Yeah.
Could have been some sergeant thought of it, sort of common sense idea, actually.
Yeah, exactly. But it's so counterintuitive, huh? You know, on the other hand, it's so kind of against your feeling, yeah? That's exactly the point. There's so many simple things against your feeling. And this is a good example of it.
Right.
Shall we? Enlighten me?
We're going to quit at 4 hours. You've got 15 minutes to go. And go have a drink. Maybe.
Quit at 4 hours, not quit in 4 hours.
What?
It's not quit in 4 hours.
No. We quit here. We quit this room. You know.
How are neural networks, you were saying that they're considered microbes? I don't know.
Oh. Typically, there's a network topology in modern neural networks. It's not like a perceptron where you just have a series of matrices separated by sigmoidal functions. Now they have an array of matrices, all of which are being simultaneously fit. And they fit together in sort of interesting topologies, they call them, but they're really just graphs, directed graphs. So you have a bunch of essentially linear functions composed with nonlinear smoothing functions. And they go forward in some complicated fashion, all of which are being fit. But any one of those could feed to multiple ones down the line. So you have sort of this multi-in, multi-out thing that ultimately classifies. So lots of times you have outputs of several matrices going as inputs to the next matrix. So lots of multi-to-one and one-to-many.
No, but since superposition, composition of function many variables. And the logic of this was formalized by operators. And the fact that function numerical may be less relevant than this formal combinatorics of composing thing, yes, of errors. But of course, I don't know enough about this neural networks to say something meaningful.
The way you describe the way you feel the brain functions.
No, this is no idea. About no, brain, I have no idea. I have no idea how brain works. So this is not for not
the way you've been talking about it, that we...
No, it's not brain. No, wait.
Wait. Let him get the feeling of his question.
Well, no, I might not be using the right word, but you talk about how we can distinguish sort of simple relations.
Yes.
Maybe things are the same, or they're not quite the same, but they're similar.
Right.
And then we can look at relations between those relations. And I'm just saying that characterization, I'm not sure what you're describing, how maybe the brain works, or... But I'm just saying that makes me think of like higher
category. No, again, we say brain, it is electrophysiology of brain studies by neurophysiologists, absurd for us to say something about that. That's experimental science, right? And we just cannot say anything. Then we have our mind, which we see before us, and we can speak about it, but it's useless, because this is exactly what people try to imitate. It's useless, because it has no structure to model. And there is this idea of Turing kind of imitation game, which is absurd, right? You can do it, so what? Maybe you can imitate it by huge memory. It's not what you want. What you believe, however, that there is a machinery, logical machinery behind your brain, behind your mind, which generates by the brain. You have no idea how it's done. It's not our business. And this intermediate thing we want to understand and imagine what mathematically it can be. It may be wrong what we imagine, but the point is if you can use it to make artificial kind of behavior, of this kind. It may be not exactly what we have, but you're motivated by what you know from evolution, from biology, there are little indications which suggest what it can be. So which the more you know, of course, it's maybe more useful, but a posteriori, it will be abstract kind of quasi-mathematical thing, because you can't quite formalize it. Eventually, it might go to computer before you understand formally, because it might be too complicated.
So can I, even though this would be wrong, because you've already said it's wrong, you can imagine there would be you would imagine some graphs, and then you would imagine some projection operators and information, and you somehow make a mechanism.
Yes.
And you could describe something, and you could say, that's the way we think, or something.
Right.
But this would be perfectly sensible, what you would say. It would make sense. But he says, try to find the right one. Every one that's been suggested is inadequate so far.
Because it tried to explain your mind. But this it's not the point of explaining. It's not structural. You cannot explain it. But you can explain mechanism behind it. And this is invisible to you.
There's nothing to explain. You have to recreate.
Oh, it's the mechanism.
Recreate this mechanism. And this will learning mechanism, as it is, again, super complicated, but the way it was created, you have an impulse, very complicated input. And for that reason, it's complicated. But the way it was starting working was very simple. And the simpler you have to guess what it is. And you don't have indication, like in the animals, there's very primitive, basic mechanism from which more complicated behavior emerges. And also our mind, which always complexity, it's kind of a tree. And in the core there is complicated, kind of not interesting things, but what we see, majority is trees, it's trivial structure. Huge, but it's trivial. Like all human culture, it's huge, but it's trivial. Just absolutely, I mean, just memory, I mean. But the moment you understand inside my computer with all our qualities, which we're so proud of, they're trivial. Non-trivial is this little, very little simple mechanism. And once you know it, will be, maybe it's so simple, just when you show it to you, it's obvious. Then you have to implement it. My very probably quite simple mathematical model. And then out of this, it can grow, let this input, and of course, grows up.
You mean you wouldn't be able to reject a given suggestion immediately?
Yeah, if it will be really, really good, yeah. If you guess what? It right, if you guess it right. Again.
No, I'm saying, can you reject suggestions as being wrong?
Yeah. Of course.
Easily?
Of course.
By saying, giving some biological information that would be incompatible? This couldn't be an explanation because it would require too many inputs or something.
Say it again?
Yeah. See. I can imagine you could come up with a scheme of ideas, an abstract one, like a Lie group or something.
Yeah.
But you'd need to know a specific Lie group to make it look like the brain. So, and maybe that Lie group doesn't exist.
Yeah. Maybe.
You can prove it doesn't exist, and then therefore, this is not a good model.
Yeah, of course.
Right.
No, but,
I mean, because you had other considerations. The Lie group looks like the right idea, but you add some other conditions after I give my idea of a Lie group.
No, absolutely. And then the only convincing
this Lie group doesn't exist. What?
The only convincing thing to make computer program which will do that.
What?
You have to implement it on a computer. So just my guess, if you do it right, you can do it on your laptop. It will be quite simple. It will be primitive, but you can really make artificial
mind. Implement it to do what?
We start conversing to this guy on your computer.
Have it learn, have it be born, and have it learn.
Yeah, it will be born, then you start giving information, it will learn, it will be fast, it will be fast, the computer works fast, and in a matter of time, you start conversing with him and realize you're kind of not an idiot. Right? Maybe we're primitive, but still,
so you create these mathematicians, sort of, or whatever you want. Sounds scary.
No, actually, some people are very scared. They have artificial intelligence with all those kind of
stuff.
People, you know, Hawking is one of the people who is afraid of artificial intelligence.
Yeah.
It may come and ask people here on the net, make this lecture. They imagine with all these kind of wisest people have this artificial thing will come. But they like a knife. Yeah, they don't do anything unless you use them. We don't inherently, all our human qualities are not part of our intelligence, so to speak. They're cultural, they're external, they're evolutional. But this mechanism is perpendicular, just like mathematical structure, that's it. Once out of this, many things may grow. It's neutral.
So I think you can formulate a precise question here. Build some kind of picture that can be implemented on a computer to perform a certain task, which would be...
No, not us, no, exactly, forget about
it. But would actually,
behaving in an interesting way. Behaving in an interesting way. And this interesting, they appreciate your interest.
What?
Behaving in an interesting way.
It would produce something of behavior.
Like talking to you, if you're good, if it finds you interesting, it will talk to you. Right? Or learning things, which, for example, about chess. Let me give another example. People make algorithms for chess. Okay, they're not good at that. But the point is, how to imitate the fact the children, some of them find it interesting and will spontaneously start learning chess. How to make a program that would find chess interesting without specifically, of course, trained for chess. Given possibility, it will start learning chess program. Let me give you a more formal question. If you have a chess
program, would want to learn chess
or anything interesting. That's exactly what makes different for human. Not what they do can do that. They want to do that. What motivates you, right? And that is a fundamental. Another related thing. If you take a chess master, look at the play.
This is scary. I don't want the computer. How do you get the computer program to want something?
Hmm? Oh, no, given possibilities.
Huh?
Having a random sequence of signals, or constant signal of signals, and a bunch of chess partners, or many others, it will choose those. Right? Chess will be some algorithm for selection. This is one. Yeah. And but again, let me give another example. If you look at the chess master, if you look at the party people playing, they can simultaneously immediately remember that. The official could go through the room and remember 20 people, parties playing, yeah? And then can say positions, what was where, okay? However, given a random position of pieces, as bad as we are. So what's special in these positions? Can you formalize it?
Configurations that arise in play versus not?
Yeah, they all knew, yeah? What is formally in them is those which arise, which is a good party, probably replaying, he also will be difficult remembering, it will be junk, but really a good place, and they remember it. So what is the difference? How many is space of all positions? What is percentage of interesting ones? Can you say it roughly? What is
the percentage?
Yeah.
Very small, I think.
Yeah, but still maybe exponentially large. But still maybe small. And so how it happens, you remember it. So what is the mechanism of the brain? If you ask what's special in the position, and secondly, what is the mechanism of the brain? So if you react, you can recognize them so fast, and then remember it. Another point about actors.
But that's not hard to imagine. I mean, there's a few sort of motifs that are chosen, and there's a few variations.
No, but you have to do it formally. You have to give universal formal algorithm which apply here in distinguished interesting ones. Of course, you can make ad hoc description, and even that would be not so easy, by the way. You have to make a major computer program doing that, not just so you have kind of generic words. What would be the problem? Really rigorous mathematical, maybe at that moment you don't say exactly, but something really very specific. Another point, people relate this thing in your psychology, people who are playing, you know, in theater, and they first have difficulty remembering, you know, playing by heart. But for some moment they become pretty good at that. And given a new play, they remember it pretty well. But if you give them technical text, it will be as bad as if they didn't know anything. So what common have these things that help them to remember it?
A visual picture?
No. It's not just words. You might say, what in the brain makes remember completely new thing? So what patterns they have in common? So my idea is you have kind of room how to remember them. So there is some underlying structure. You remember the structure, and then details are easier to fill in. But the point is the structure. If it's not structured, you can't remember it.
Yeah, but I don't think that's a conceptually impossible problem. That seems doable.
No, if you can't make such a problem.
I think you can make
such a
problem.
How do you do that? How do you extract? Do you extract? Is this a hidden structure there which you don't know to where? And your mind extract it.
The chess problem, you could solve that with neural networks.
Hmm?
The chess problem, you could do that with neural networks. I'm perfectly confident in that.
No,
you give me a million pictures of positions that arise in chess,
you don't
I will train a computer that recognizes chess positions for you.
A million is a little bit too much. You have less. Yeah, million is a big number. So it's still even a million. And then...
No, we probably need less.
Okay, how about 60,000? 60,000?
No, I don't think you can do it. No, I doubt
really?
It. No. I doubt it. If you can do it, it would be very remarkable, but I don't think so.
That seems pretty doable.
No, I don't think so. Hey, this just looks extremely unlikely. Because if you think about that, it is quite subtle. And then there are some certain things very difficult because there are some rare configuration, which may not happen. And then they classified immediately, of course, the good player could see the level of the game. Even kind of, if you play on some level, you immediately see all levels below that. So I'm curious what your network will be able, on which level it classified them.
Well, I admit they'd be...
So which parties you take? Mm. And then, you know, it's not so much... I'm curious if you can do it.
You changed the problem, though. It's a harder problem to rank the play of the game from the position on the board.
No, that's not what he was saying. He's saying that certain configurations are going to be implausible for at certain levels of play, and that somehow the classifiers can only know things up to a certain level of play,
of course.
And not a higher
level.
There
are obvious things, of course, it never happens. Yeah, I guess you know. There are obvious things which don't happen, but that it's very primitive level. I agree on this very simplistic level that you don't have two positions on the wrong places and one hitting another, king being attacked or whatever. That's, of course, rather simple, okay. This local thing. But this is not what made the party.
The right? Rarer positions.
Yeah, it's much higher level of organization.
Okay. Yeah, you'll get more error in the positions that are less likely.
No, of course, there will be not trivial errors, but even in training, you can see how that position masters. It's a very subtle kind of thing that there's some balance, the potential of development. Yeah, I mean, it's I don't think it's easy to make. I don't know. I may be quite wrong. But that's if what you say is true, it would be very interesting.
Yeah, it's exactly the kind of problem that neural networks have been doing pretty well at in recent years.
These sorts of
classifications.
No, but not that point, because classification is hidden. What you classify by potential is not but what you see, right? It's just you have to know idea that there will be move made. And of course, looking at that, he knows why this position, because this move leads to that, that move leads to this. How a neural network would know that? You had no idea of chess. Because here you have to develop this position and see how it transforms and potential moves. If immediately one side wins, it might be premature position. But it must be rather tricky organized. Right? You agree? It's still possible. Maybe it's still possible, but it's unclear. If you combine that with chess playing algorithms, and so to see how the thing will develop, then maybe you can do it. But then you have to, this definitely is there in this recognition. It's not just people look at that because they have some penetration into the structure of the game, not only on the what is visible. But again, who knows? But another question, how you remember them? See, this local.
See, but I don't think. From a purely implementation point of view, I mean, you can teach the computer to play chess without ever having it actually, without teaching it the rules. I mean, just by showing it enough games.
This is another interesting point. Just how much example you have to show to computer to learn, but then you have to extrapolate. And so, what is the logic of this extrapolation? Because our perception very much depends on we have already a geometric point, you know, this is a line and this is a line. So if this you don't have it, take long time to understand the moves, right? Even just to guess their formal behavior. Because for even very simple positions, there are millions of possibilities. Mm-hmm. And we guess them because modular, our knowledge of geometry, they're kind of the simplest one, right? So we have very little input. Right. Because logically, they will be the simplest, again, modular that we have all the symmetries, right? All this motion have presenting symmetry. But you have to have a symmetry already in your mind. Mm-hmm. And that's one of the difficulties. If you want to make it a good universal program, even for chess, you already have to have background for which you always have a perception of spatial symmetries. And that may be also true about languages. You cannot make a good program for language if you don't have an idea of symmetries.
Of what?
Of symmetries.
Symmetry.
Or something of that kind, yeah. It's a little, maybe not really, but significant input of particular kind. And definitely, symmetries have something to do with our, you know, we have special, symmetry plays a special role.
Sorry, so what are the symmetries in a language that are important?
Well, trivial symmetry is that, for example, certain words you hate to be repeated. Right? Well, this is just very...
Like his and...
You use pronouns. With guys because you don't want it to be repeated. And some words, of course, repeat a lot, and they kind of not just, you know, auxiliary words, they repeat a lot. But meaningful words, they typically not repeated. That's a very primitive kind of symmetry, of course. But there may be more, of the symmetries which we may hidden from us. Mm-hmm. And this is symmetry which allow you to remember this big jumps of text, because there are hidden symmetries which are not aware of.
I see.
You know, the longest seminar went to 8:30. I don't think we can be on record.
Yeah, okay, we'll go. Huh? We'll go on yesterday.
Let's go to that place we went to after your oral exam. Okay. You know where it is, right?
Yeah.
On 35th?
33rd.
33rd? You sure? No.
What is it?
It's a bar, hamster place.
Oh, it was... I think we went to 33rd, but...
Yeah, there are bars on 36th.
Are you talking about, like, Rattle and Hum?
Let's go to a place you can get a beer.
Rattle and Hum's on 33rd.
Salad.